Hi Nicola, welcome. How are you doing today?
I'm very well. I'm a little bit jet lagged, so I hope I can talk in complete sentences.
Okay, so there's a lot we could talk about. I mentioned that you're the former Conservative Minister for Innovation. You're also a member of the House of Lords. But in 2020, you became Chair of Genomics England. For people who are just finding out about this area, I mean, give us the basics. What is genomics and how is it relevant to our healthcare?
So genomics is the application of the science of studying our DNA and our genomic data. So, you know, our genome is basically the code of our entire body. You know, it's 3 billion letters, which will really design everything about you, the color of your hair and everything. 99.2% of that data is the same in everyone, but in 0.2% of those cases, there's variation. Some of that variation is fine, but some of that can be disease causing. And as we learn more about this, we can not only diagnose people earlier and more accurately, but we can also design much more personalized medicines. And the UK is really at the forefront of genomic medicine, diagnostics, and healthcare. And that is why we not only have the UK Biobank, which is a healthy cohort, we have Genomics England, which started off with the 100,000 genome project. And we also now have a new 5 million project, UK Future Health. And I'm just going to give you an example to show you what you can do with this. Jessica was one of the first patients to go through the 100,000 genome project, and she had a form of epilepsy that wasn't really responding to treatment. The first pass through 100,000 found 6.4 million variants between her genome and the reference genome. Of those, nearly 700,000 were rare, and of those, 3,000 predicted to cause some form of change in the gene protein. They then compared those 3,000 with her parents, and they found 67 that were different. We checked those 67 against something we have, which is called the panel app, which is an open source resource of understanding genomic research around the world. And that found one, which linked her symptoms to others that were similar with epileptics around the world. And that gave us the answer to what was causing Jessica's rare disease. It was the SLC2A1 gene. And through that, what we understood was that just by changing Jessica's diet to a special diet, she could improve dramatically. Not only could her health improve dramatically, but also she could reduce her dependence on drugs. And she was one of the first patients to be diagnosed through the 100,000 Genome Project. We also found that through using the 100,000, 25% of rare disease patients got a diagnosis for the first time. 50% of cancer patients were referred to a therapeutic that they never would have discovered otherwise. So this is the sort of outcome you can get from using genomics for diagnostics.
Mm-hmm. And one of the great promises is that it will cut short this really long, awful, drawn-out process for some people where they can spend years sometimes looking for this diagnosis. I know that you've got first-hand experience of this. I mean, could you tell us a little bit about what you've called your diagnostic odyssey?
Yeah, so I have a rare disease called Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, so it's not surprising that this is a passion project for me, but it took me 30 years to get diagnosed. And the diagnostic odyssey is that you bounce from clinician to clinician, and many of these clinicians, they try desperately to diagnose you, but with rare diseases, there's over probably 10,000 that we understand at the moment, but it may be as we learn more and more about genetic causes, there are maybe up to 200,000 N of one conditions. And so it's unreasonable to expect all clinicians to understand and based on a clinical diagnosis, the case which you may have. I had many unnecessary diagnostics, including bone marrow biopsy. I was misdiagnosed many times. Sometimes I was told it must all be in my head by clinicians who I think got a bit frustrated with me. Eventually, I was accidentally diagnosed by a neurologist who happened to have experience of my condition, and he referred me to a world specialist in EDS who diagnosed me in 20 minutes. It was like 20 minutes after all those years of going round, being given drugs which really made me much sicker, and I was very sick at that point. Doctors were telling me I'd probably have to just give up work and live at home and never really contribute again. And after that, I got a lot better, but also I got an insight into the fact that there were ways that we could do this better. And what we are discovering now is that we can cut short the diagnostic odyssey, and that's what our newborn screening program is all about.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, you and Jessica, you're not obviously alone. There are 3.5 million people in the UK suffering from rare diseases, according to the government. So that's about one in every 200 people. I mean, for someone who is currently going through maybe what you went through, what Jessica went through, I mean, what difference can genomic healthcare make to them personally? What would their, how would their experience be different from yours?
So my story is a very common story. On average, a rare disease patient has 67 appointments in 75 months. This is the data that came out of the 100,000 Genome Project. And so what we're hoping to do is really cut that short. At the moment, around 5,000 patients a month are coming through the Genomics Medicine Service, which has been set up by Genomics England. So we are delivering whole genome sequencing as a standard of care to rare disease and cancer patients within the NHS now. And we're hoping to scale this up, but also bring that right back with our newborn screening project, which will look at bringing this to the birth cohort. Because at the moment, about 70% of rare disease patients are children, and about 30% of those die before the age of five. If you're waiting 5 years to get a diagnosis, you'll remain undiagnosed. And only about 5% of rare diseases have any form of therapeutic. So we're hoping to cut that short by not only having the diagnostics within the system, but also making our data set available for researchers and industry to bring therapeutics and better diagnostics back into the clinical care. We have about 8 out of 10 pharma companies and many more biotechs and researchers working all the time on our data to bring better clinical care into the community, both with rare cancers and rare diseases.
Mm-hmm. And I want to come on to the newborn screening program in a minute, but I mean, can you give us an idea of what difference this is making to clinicians' everyday work? I mean, last time we spoke, you talked about some clinicians are using this to change treatment in like 80% of their patients.
So we've had some really exciting feedback now that the service is really in use within the community. One particular clinician at Great Ormond Street, Dr. Jack Bartram, ran the service within his haematology pediatric clinic. And he found that in about 81% of cases using whole genome sequencing, was additional information for improving care. In about 24% of cases, it actually changed the way in which he delivered care. In about 14% of cases, it changed diagnosis. So this is really talking about a fundamental shift in the way we're delivering care in the UK.
Mm-hmm. And the newborn screening program, I mean, it's my understanding about one in 200 babies are expected to receive a diagnosis in this program. Is that right? Yeah. But what about this concern? I mean, some people are a bit worried that people might not want to know if they're predisposed to a genetic condition. I mean, what's your response to that?
Well, the first thing is, it is optional to participate in the newborn screening program. There is a consent process that will be very, you know, orderly during the process of engaging with the maternity community, and you will not have to have the screening. You will not have to participate in the research project. If you do, however, the only results that will be returned to the mother and child will be those which are actionable at the time of birth, and it will only be 200 rare diseases, and we may increase that up to 300, which are then able to be integrated within the clinical pathway. It's no good really getting a diagnosis if that you can't do something about it at this stage. What we hope is that as we have more research and as we have more innovation coming through that loop that I described of research into clinical care and back into research, we'll be able to add more rare diseases, more therapeutics back to patients. But it is the right thing to do that we only provide information back to parents and children, that there is something that they can do something with.
Mm-hmm. You also mentioned the Cancer 2.0 program. Can you tell us a bit about that?
So we've been funded as well. So we have, our business as usual is the Genomics Medicine Service, which provides, as I've said, diagnostics for rare disease and cancer patients. But we've also been funded to do the newborn screening program, but also to improve the use of next generation technologies for cancer. This is the Cancer 2.0 program. And, innovation in this area is driving very quickly, but it's important that we only use validated technologies. And because of the XR expansion through one of the most integrated healthcare systems, we are the best place really to validate these technologies. So these are technologies such as long read sequencing like Oxford Nanopore, but also others, and working out how those would integrate into the clinical pathway. So it might be that you would reuse a long read technology at the bedside, combining it with short read like Illumina, so that you could get ongoing diagnostics of a tumor while you're going through cancer care. And that might provide you with optimal visibility over the best therapeutic while you have cancer care.
And when it comes to integrating these technologies, I mean, the NHS is a huge, unwieldy organization. I mean, how difficult is it actually to kind of change this way of working and to introduce these new practices?
Well, I think anybody in this room who's introduced a technology into the NHS will know, and they will feel when I say it has not been simple or straightforward. But we've been working with the NHS from the beginning, from developing genomics healthcare, it's from being a research project with 100,000, which started in 2012 when it was just an idea from a round table at the 2012 Olympics, through developing the 100,000 Genome Project, which I think was more difficult than anyone imagined it would be, through turning Genomics England into essentially a service company which delivers care to patients. And we've made many mistakes and got many things wrong along the way. But one of the things that we've learned is it's not just about having the science and the technology and the skill, which we've always had in buckets in the UK since Watson and Crick, but it's also about having the right partnerships and relationships and making sure that when things do go wrong, we're very quick to put them right. And so we have partnership boards which work between Genomics England and the NHS all the way down to working groups on the ground to make sure that we can build confidence and trust. And the second thing that we have is we have patients at the heart of everything that we do. We have a patient participant panel of 25 participants who hold the board to account on every decision that we make. And that's not just about how we design clinical trials, it's about how we structure our company and every contract that we undertake, because I mean we're holding one of the most precious data sets in the country. And if we're going to maintain that trust, it needs to be the people who have the most at stake who scrutinize what we do. And that is one of the most important principles of our company.
I mean, you mentioned things that have gone wrong. I mean, can you give us an example of something that went wrong that you were able to correct later?
Well, so, one of the fundamental principles of delivering cancer care is that you need to deliver results in a timely manner. And so turnaround times for cancer are notoriously difficult for genomic healthcare. And one of the issues is getting fresh frozen samples from the bedside through various different points in the pathway to your sequencing center, validated through your bio pathways and back to the clinician in a timely manner to actually deliver care. One of the biggest problems, bizarrely, was where the fridges were going to be put in the hospitals, because you were going to have to unplug the photocopier. There wasn't actually space to integrate within a capital environment that we have at the moment, an entirely new structure. And so that sounds like a simple challenge, but actually just that little pathway problem. And you can imagine barrier after barrier after barrier like that needed to be unlocked, and every single bit of friction within the pathway needed to be done. And our turnaround times still need improvement, and we're still working on making sure that we can turn around cancer results in a time that's meaningful. For Genomics England, that turnaround time is for cancer is now 2.2 days. We still need to reduce it all the way through our pathway.
What's the aim for the turnaround time?
In under 2 weeks.
Okay. So another question that is often raised about this area of healthcare is, who exactly is genomics going to help? I mean, there's been a lot of discussion about the missing genes, about how more than 80% of existing genomic studies are based on data collected from white Europeans. And that's quite a dramatic bias. And that basically means that genetic testing on people of other ethnicities can be a lot less accurate. I mean, why does this problem exist, and what can you do to correct it?
So it's absolutely right that our data set in the 100,000 genome project was not as representative as we wanted it to be. And so I'm really pleased that we've been funded from last year to diversify our data set, and we are currently actively seeking sequencing those from diverse backgrounds. We have a target to sequence over 25,000 individuals from diverse backgrounds, but we're also working on a more sustainable model, which is engaging with communities who are least represented and underserved at the moment to make sure that we can have representation going forward. So we're trying to put right the historical bias and make sure that that bias is not continued going forward. And we're also working on engagement with other data sets around the world, such as H3 Africa and all of us, to make sure that we can have the right research represented within our data sets, so that we can do excellent diagnosis in areas such as sickle cell, which is more represented from in certain communities.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Just a reminder for the audience, if you'd like to ask questions, you can do so on Slido. One more question from me is that you mentioned this is kind of one of the most precious data sets in the country. I mean, can you explain a bit about how you're keeping it secure? I know there was some allegations by a minister that that Genomics England had been subject to some hacking attempts by a Chinese competitor.
So he corrected that record, and I'm happy to correct that here as well. Our data set is very secure. We spend a lot of time ensuring that the cyber security of the data set is assured. We have our data in a cloud-based data set, which is monitored on a daily basis, and I'm very happy with the quality and the effectiveness of our security community. The one thing that I would say that, Genomics England is one of the earliest trusted research environments. Unlike Biobank and some of the other data sets, we don't allow people to come and take the data away. We allow researchers, having been through our research review community to assure that they are validated researchers, to come and do research in the data set. And we have done a huge amount of work to make that UX very user-friendly, so it's easy to navigate and you can find what you want very easily, and we have teams to help you with that. But then you can look, we describe it like an aquarium. You can come and look at the fish, you can come and play with the fish, you can make friends with the fish, but you do not put your hands into the aquarium and take the piranha away. You will not be invited back. So you can take your foreground IP away, but you do not take our data away. We keep it safe, and that is part of the arrangement with our participants, that they are confident that their data is kept safe and secure. The Chinese have no say in that.
Mm-hmm. Question from the audience. How affordable is it to offer whole genome sequencing to everyone with red flag symptoms of a rare disease?
So it's extraordinary how the price of whole genome sequencing has just plummeted since it was originally sequenced. I'm trying to remember off the top of my head the cost of sequencing the original human genome. It was in the billions. And now we're looking at, with the new Illumina machines, it being like somewhere around $200 a whole genome. So it's becoming very affordable, and it's becoming increasingly affordable with the next-gen sequencing technologies. But I think what's most interesting is how different technologies can be combined to get the best outcome, because it may be that what you want is a combination of a panel plus a whole genome, and what we want to establish is what the best combination for your indication is. And that's why the UK is really at the forefront of genomics, because our researchers have the ability to use the combination. We haven't talked about combining data sets really, because genomic data is great, but it's not, you don't get your discoveries by genomic data alone. What we do is we combine data. So we have genomic data plus cancer regime data plus imaging data. We're going to have some of the best high definition cancer data in the world, combining with our 100,000 genome data. And it's that research environment that gives you the 360 degree understanding of what's going on with the patient, and can not only allow diagnostic discovery, but also real therapeutic insight. One of our industry partners on a particular indication not only found 9 loci which were relevant for discovering a target, took one into the wet lab, but are now all the way through to phase 1 in under 2 years. The head of their therapeutic discovery has said it has completely transformed their understanding of where you can go with genetic discovery, and it's because of the combination of data and the way in which that can drive discovery that we're at this point.
I'm going to squeeze in one more question just because there are so many. There's lots of questions about what else we can use genomics for. People are asking, can you use it for ADHD, autism, fertility treatments, mental health illnesses?
So you can use it for these applications if you have the right combination of data, I think is the answer to that. So we have some really strong data on neurodevelopmental disorders. But as I've said, you need to combine it with the right proteomic data, the right non-genomic data in order to make sure that you can really get the right clinical insights. And it also depends what you want to discover from it. So are you looking to discover a diagnostic? Are you looking to discover a therapeutic? But come and talk to our team and we can tell you if we have the right data to support your research.
Great. Thank you very much, Nicola. Thank you.